Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of Q&A with Dr. J. We are from My Happy Genes, the best genetic testing company on the planet. Okay, there I said it for many reasons. And you can go to our website now and find out what those reasons are because we've done a great chart explaining the differences between our company and the other four main companies out there. Because we want you to have choice, right? Choice is very important. We want you to make the right decision for you. Today, we're talking about energy production and or the lack thereof due to genetic variations. Take it away, Jay.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, this is kind of a, I think, a universally popular topic because we're all like, yeah, I could use a little more energy. That would be great. I see little kids running around and I go, wow, where did that energy go?
Yeah.
But however, they have these bursts of energy where they go, blah, 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 and then they're down for a good couple of hours and then they're back. I see that with my dog too. He's just fine. At the moment's notice, he's got, and then boom, he's on the floor for most of the day. I think resting may be one of the secrets to energy, but I want to talk about some genetic variants and how it can contribute to lack of energy, but also I want to talk about how our environment damages our mitochondria and can lead to low energy as well, because I think that's a rampant sort of issue. Without hoping not to get too technical, I want to go into our biochemical pathway chart.
Yeah, please.
Are we good with that?
Sure.
Right. There it is in all of its glory. So I want to take you through this pathway here. I'm going to have to put my glasses on because I can't see that. This is where this pathway, this is the citric acid cycle, and this is where we make energy. And you can see the little energy thing down at the bottom here. But our food comes into here and it's converted from sugars. We make simple sugars, basically. From proteins, we make amino acids. And from fats, we make fatty acids. And they all feed into the citric acid cycle in one way or the other. So with these pathways, we look at, you can see here glucose, the arrow pointing to pyruvate. And this enzyme is responsible for turning glucose into pyruvate. And our genes tell our bodies how to make those enzymes. So if you got the wrong code for these enzymes because of a genetic variant that you inherited from mom and dad, which makes it homozygous, it can reduce the activity of that enzyme by about 70%.
Wow.
Kind of a big hit. And so if you have a problem in any of these enzymes, it can really slow down your ability to turn glucose into energy, which can then lead to obviously low energy, but also it can raise your glucose because the glucose kind of backs up in your system and it blood sugar issues and insulin resistance is a huge problem, especially in the United States for lots of reasons. But one reason that I think is overlooked is the fact that we can have genetic variants along here, but we can also have damage to the electron transport chain. I'm going to take you down there in a minute. But basically in the mitochondria, and we've mentioned the mitochondria before. But if there's a slowdown in the pathway, it's like an 8-lane highway coming down into 2 lanes. All the traffic's going to back up behind that 2 lanes, right? And glucose will back up, and insulin resistance is a natural consequence of that. Our cells that normally would receive insulin get resistant and they close, and insulin can't get in there. It causes our insulin to go up and can cause diabetes eventually. But so our body is converting all of these nutrients into energy through these pathways. So it goes around the citric acid cycle and then down into the electron transport chain. And these particular genetic variants down here are really going to slow things down. If you've inherited genetic variants there, everything is going to be sluggish. You're going to be really good at holding on to weight, which is not fun because maybe your ancestors survived during times of starvation and you inherited genetic variants there that keep your metabolism at a slow level. We all know people who can eat anything they want and never gain weight. And it's just like they're so annoying. Those of us who have inherited genes that make us hold on to weight really easily. And these genetic variants, they can slow down this whole process, but there are ways that we can speed it up. And we look at something called cofactors. So, for instance, if you've inherited that NDUFS gene and you have a slow enzyme there, its cofactors are carnitine and CoQ10. So, it speeds up that thing. And so, for each of these genetic variants that we find on you, we have coenzymes or cofactors that speed up the enzyme and make up for the fact that you inherited a genetic variant there, which is very cool. But when we get into the electron transport chain, and I hope I don't freak you guys out here too much, but basically the electron transport chain transports electrons down a chain. Imagine that. Its job is to turn basic nutrients into energy over here. So we make ATP, which is our basic unit of energy. But there's lots of things that can gunk us up along the way and keep that from happening. And one of them is mercury. Others are insecticides, antibiotics, fluoride, chlorine, electromagnetic fields, radiation, heavy metals, and medications. If you look at this list of medications here, all kinds of prescription medications can actually damage mitochondria. And mitochondria, these little tiny organelles inside of our cells that are trying to make energy, they're easily damaged by the environment. They don't have a lot of protection around them like our regular cells do. So it's really important that we look at, you and I just briefly talked about electromagnetic fields, holding a cell phone up to your ear. It's not a good idea. Heavy metals, looking at, are you eating a lot of fish with mercury? Do you have mercury fillings in your mouth? Are you using light bulbs that have mercury? Is there coal burning in your area? Because that actually creates mercury as well. It can damage the mitochondria. Antibiotics, those people who have had many rounds of antibiotics definitely have issues around energy production and eventually can really, it can create a lot of weight problems. Also, chemotherapy from cancer treatments can definitely damage the mitochondria. And that's often why people get a relapse of their cancers because they've really damaged their energy production pathways. And there's a lot of evidence pointing to mitochondrial damage as the source of cancers. Insecticides, again, eating organic is a really good idea. Know there's a lot of controversy about fluoride and chlorine, but they do actually slow down this complex one, the second part of this chain reaction here. So there's some ways that we can start to protect ourselves, thinking about these things, being a little more aware of your environment and how it's going to affect your energy production capacity. But also, when you get your genes tested, we can look at, oh, you've got this genetic variant here. We need to give you these cofactors to make up for it and get your mitochondria working the way it could work and speed up your metabolism, which is a wonderful thing. Another interesting piece of this is that our thyroid is a good part of metabolism. So if we have a low thyroid, a lot of people really gain weight and obviously they're tired and they're going to lose hair. You're going to see various symptoms that are going to point to low thyroid. Weight gain, depression,
Cold.
constipation, being
Yep, cold.
cold. Yeah, cold body temperature. And it's largely because it governs how fast that citric acid cycle is going to spin. So let's say we start up your mitochondria and we get the right nutrients in there. It's like putting gas in the tank. And then if there is thyroid dysfunction, if we turn that on at the same time, it's like putting gas in the tank and putting your foot on the pedal. They work together to really start up the metabolism, and it's a really cool thing. You should see your body temperature go up to 98.6. Most people, if you take their body temperature, it's at 97, 98, if that, but it's pretty rare because there's so many people that have mitochondrial damage or thyroid dysfunction. And together it's a kind of a lethal combination.
That's why we got meds. No, I'm kidding. I like your way better. Meds are great. I got nothing against meds when you need them.
Yeah. There are genetic variants that also can impair thyroid function. And in some cases, it's gone on so long that the thyroid kind of stops working correctly. And in those cases, for some people, they're going to need some meds. And I think you have the COMT gene, which is also associated with low thyroid function. And especially over a long period of time, it can really damage the thyroid and Did you have some of it removed or something?
No,
Okay.
but you talked, we did an estrogen video not too long ago, and estrogen dominance is also one of the things that affects the thyroid. And I think I had it for so long, such a raging case of it, that it just, my thyroid said, I'm going to bed now, not getting up again.
Exactly. And stress, it needs to be mentioned because chronic stress, a high adrenal level, actually increases your cortisol. And cortisol is another one of those, along with estrogen, that interferes with thyroid function. It's gonna save your life. Basically, it's gonna turn down your metabolism so you don't burn out and kill yourself. Our body has this little feedback mechanism for making something called reverse T3, which is inactive form of thyroid, and it turns off your metabolism. So it's just trying to save your life, essentially. It's amazing how our body has those little feedback mechanisms.
Thank goodness.
Yeah. Not fun. It feels bad because you're gaining weight along with being tired, and but at least you're alive.
This is true.
Yeah. So one of the symptoms of this problem with mitochondria is sugar cravings. And we've talked about them in the context of addiction, but also when somebody comes in, they say, I crave sugars like crazy. I'm like, then you probably, your mitochondria is not functioning correctly, because when you make energy out of your food, your body goes, I don't want it. It doesn't really sound good. And I hear that consistently with people. After we get their mitochondria function going, they're like, yeah, I don't know. I'll take a bite of dessert, but it doesn't really taste very good. And I don't really want it anymore, because I was a sugar addict. And it's really cool to see that we fine-tune your engines so that they're working correctly and you're making energy correctly. That's a very cool thing.
Oh yeah, especially with the sugar. We talked about inflammaging. We said the word, we didn't really talk about it, but inflammation ages us, and glycation is a word like glucose glycation. It's basically rust. It's rusting us, all that sugar, right? So if we can turn down the desire for sugar in people, it's a win-win all around.
Yeah, and I really think our environment is very different than our ancestors. We didn't have the pesticides and chemicals and radiation and heavy metals
Fruit Loops.
that we do now. And it's really epidemic proportions where we have mitochondrial damage, and you're going to see the increase in cancers and in diabetes and sugar cravings. And there's just, like you say, it's too easy to get sugar or to get calories, and they taste good, and you're tired, and you're trying to get more energy. So it's going to contribute to all those things, damage it even further. And the inflammation and aging happens much faster.
Yes, it does. But now we have all this good information, and anybody listening who is interested in getting their genes tested, you know where to go, myhappygenes.com. And if you're just discovering My Happy Genes, do go to the website. We've got lots of information, not only about why we're different, but about how gene testing could benefit you, how to work with a practitioner, how we train our practitioners. Lots of information there. So if you have questions, and it's not one of these kind of questions that we're going to answer on video, just head over there, and if you do have questions, then write info@myhappygenes.com, and our fabulous customer service person, whose name shall go unmentioned because people think she's a bot, but her name is Helen. She will happily answer you and give you all the time you need to get your answers.
She's fantastic.
She really is fantastic, and she's not a bot. All right, people, be well till next time. We'll be back with another Q&A with Dr. J very soon. Thank you, Dr. J.
Thanks, TC. Good to see you.
Likewise.